So this question of why do people in sadhana wear malas or rings, or they have things on their hands, like I have a silver bracelet on my hand. Why do they wear rings? Why do they wear malas? Why do they put ash? Those kind of things. It's actually quite an interesting subject. It's quite a fascinating subject. See, one thing we must understand is that yoga is very ancient. So in 6,000 years, they figured out that certain things help and certain things don't help. So if you, the Rudraksha Mala, for instance, the Rudraksha Mala fundamentally has a certain vibrational quality which yogis discover. What is it? It's like basically seed. They discover that it has a certain vibrational quality which helps in multiple dimensions. The Rudraksha Mala is essentially a yogic thermostat. It keeps your energy at a certain even keel. If you're going out of bounds, it brings it back. If you're slipping down below, it keeps. So it essentially keeps your energy stable and enables you to be stable, because if you're doing especially our 8 spiritual breaths kind of process, if you're doing that kind of hardcore kriya based, pranayama based, kundalini yoga based process, your energy is bound to fluctuate. Your energy is bound to erupt on some days and you are bound to slump on the other days. So the first and core thing that the Rudraksha Mala does is that it gives you a certain stability. It keeps you at a certain level of vibration. On the other hand, if you are not doing these kind of vigorous processes, or if you are not doing these kind of powerful sadhanas, its Rudraksha is not the best idea, because then the Rudraksha, because it is the nature of the Rudraksha, it can trigger you. And many people do have, they find that wearing a Rudraksha Mala causes intense heat in the body, causes intense discomfort, and those are people who are not doing the kind of sadhana that we are doing. They are not doing the kind of, then of course there is the whole cultural aspect to it, that only the Shaivites wear and the Vaishnavites don't wear, which actually is just very absurd. But it has become deep-seated now. Therefore, it means that the yoga-based, tantra-based, aghora-based, ugra-shigra, tivra-based, you know, fast, intense, piercing, those kind of paths, they tend to prefer, they collect around the Rudraksha Mala. It basically means the Shaivas and the Shaktas, the Shiva worshippers and the Shakti worshippers, they end up with the Rudraksha Mala. Though that is not the purpose. The Rudraksha is just a certain vibrational quality it has. And depending on the Mukhis, I am not getting into all that. Eka Mukhi and this, that and all that, I am not getting into all. Yes, all that makes a difference. But you look at the length of the malas, when they fall to a certain place in the body. The smallest malas falls to the heart chakra. So what it does, it tries to stabilize your energy in the heart chakra, which is a very good place to keep the energy, because that makes you a compassionate person. That makes you a kind person. That makes you a more loving person. It makes you operate from the emotional, the wise level of emotional, the insight of the emotional. The next level of mala, it comes to the navel. Not exactly over the navel, because that is dangerous. Because what will happen is, if it exactly over the navel is the fire tattva, so it, you might activate very fiercely. So it falls somewhere between solar plexus and navel. And then the next level of mala, it goes right down to the muladhara, when you sit. And I have seen some people with malas that go right down to the muladhara even when they are standing. Now, those are required only if you are doing intense energy processes. You don't need those lamba malas, those long malas if you are not. So, even the length of a mala tells you certain something. This mala is a stability mala, because if you can keep your energy in your hara, it makes you exceedingly healthy. Which is why all martial arts, they keep the energy in the hara. If you can keep it in the Manipuraka chakra, the body is healthy. The person is healthy, and if your body is healthy, that's 95% of the battle won. A lot of problem has happened because of the new age and because of the inverted pyramid of priorities. A lot of problem has happened in that this chakra and this chakra is privileged. Instead of strengthening your Mooladhara, your Swadhisthana and your Manipura, people are only doing, all the processes are only strengthening the upper chakras. That is why I call it the inverted pyramid. Because your foundational chakras are weak and you're strengthening the spiritual chakras. You're not strengthening the body, you're not strengthening the creative energy, you're not strengthening the life energy. And you strengthen these. So even when you wear, now why don't you all the time wear a Mooladhara Rudraksha? Because that can activate the Mooladhara or even worse the Swadhisthana. And then you are constantly tormented by sexuality and all that. So you wear those lamba malas, those extremely long malas which come down to Swadhisthana, Mooladhara, when there is particular kind of spiritual process to be done. Particular kind of havan, particular kind of cleansing. Now I'm not getting into all those, that much nitty-gritty, but those are the reasons. The length of a mala. Now, for the normal person in sadhana, a heart mala is fine. Something that comes up to the heart mala is fine. Now, something that comes slightly below the slightly above the navel, slightly below the solar plexus, that's fine. It's perfect. Even then, unless you're really full-time, long-term, experienced meditator, it is best to wear your mala only when you're going to a temple, only when you're doing your sadhana, only when you're doing your kriya. Because if you wear the mala all the time, you have to be at a certain level of intensity. Otherwise, the mala will affect you. I never tell people wear it all the time. Wear it all for. I actually say do it when you're doing your sadhana, do it when you're doing your meditation, do it. Because this, the third thing about the Rudraksha, now apart from the fact that it is a thermostat, apart from the fact that it keeps the energy stable at certain places in the body, the third thing about the Rudraksha is a tremendous filter of negativity. If there is negativity in the environment, if there is negativity in people, the Rudraksha absorbs. So it does not enter into your consciousness, it does not pollute your chitta, it does not pollute your body, it does not pollute your emotions, it does not come into your pranamaya kosha, it does not come into your energy body. All you have to do is that you come back after your meeting or your event or whatever, you come back and you hold it under running water and that negativity is washed off. It's that simple. What the yogis used to do is that they would just hold it in the running water of the stream and the pollution would be washed off. Now, it's not like I'm getting polluted by these sessions, but when I hold these kind of meditations and all that, people leave a lot of their problems. They'll drop a lot of the problems and it always goes to the person with the most intensity. I'm elected because I'm sitting at the top of the room and I will be going home with your problems. I will be going home with the problems of the people in session. No, but it all goes into the mala. So the first thing I do when I go home is immediately strip off the clothes and immediately have a bath. That's just discipline, because if I don't, then I might be stuck with some karmic release or some energy release that is not mine. Now, the faces of the Rudraksha, the benefits of having a fat Rudraksha, small Rudraksha, all fine. It is a mistake to think that the fatter and longer the Rudraksha, the more powerful. Actually, quite the reverse is true. You know, this mala I got from my favorite temple in Arunachal, and you know, they are extremely small and he took almost 2.5 times the normal price he takes, because he was like, these are not, and you know, those who have communicated what happened once I put it on. So, but see, it's very, once you are in yoga, you just pick up a mala and you know. Once you are in yoga, you just pick up a mala and you know, is this decoration or is this the real deal? So that is what a mala does. And a mala, even if you look at our murtis, if you look at our, here is a Varaha murti. Yes? Here is a Varaha murti. If you look at it carefully, all the chakras are already there. And usually they indicate the chakras by a certain mala at each one of those junctures. Now, why don't they make rudraksha and keep it around the throat? That's dangerous. Because if you keep your energy at the throat, you become a very dictatorial kind of person. A person who keeps the energy at the throat becomes a very powerful person. And usually people cannot handle power. They become very dictatorial, very domineering, very ruthless. So it is very rare, though sometimes you actually see yogis with rudraksha on the throat. But if there are senior yogis, they'll say, take it off. Because they know what this person is playing. They know that this person is trying to accumulate personal power. They'll say, take it off. It's not a good idea. And that is why nobody wears a mala over here. So sometimes you will see, there will be somebody, they'll have the mala around there. No, they'll just keep it around the head, like a headband. Now why do they wear it? Why do they wear it on the arms and the wrists? Because there are very powerful chakras over there. And you need to protect. You need to protect. The wrist is a very, very, very vulnerable space in energy terms. The wrist is a very vulnerable space in energy terms, which is why when a person of bad energy grabs your wrist, oh my God, the contamination is unbearable. And somebody I know who's like a universal nuisance in another meditation group grabbed my arm and I got so infuriated that I actually said that I wanted to cut my arm off, you know, because it took me such a long time, 3 weeks. To remove that contamination. So if I had a mala on at that space, but you know, unless you are in certain kinds of very deep processes, it's a responsibility to constantly wear a rudraksha around your wrist. You might see certain swamis and sometimes even certain political leaders, they got a big fat rudraksha mala around the hand and they are holding it. Somebody has told them that there is some contamination or there is some negativity and you need to protect yourself. Now, some people wear these kind of wristbands or these. Now, these are metal. Any kind of metal that a yogi wears is actually a way to keep from prematurely dropping the body. If you come into a certain state of intensity, you begin to realize that I can shake loose from the body and I am free of all this karma and this whole nuisance of embodiment. So, I can drop the body. But as long as you have metal on your body, it's not going to be possible. The metal will prevent the life energy from dissociating from the annamaya kosha. So, the metal is worn to keep, this for instance was not, it was specifically tied onto me by a senior yogi that you are not to be trusted, you will not fulfill your responsibilities, so don't you dare to take it off. You have to hold it, otherwise it's very easy to escape, no, alright, I'm done, you know. I have accomplished, let's leave this whole wheel of pain and suffering. And then all the karma that you have, other people have to clean up. So they are not particularly interested in cleaning up your karmic relationships with your students. So it's a unique. Now, wearing a ring on each finger, now when I teach the mudra workshops, people understand. You know, because this is the finger of power, this is the finger of Jupiter. You know, this is the finger of Guru. And this is the finger of Saturn. So now you know why middle finger, when you show to somebody, may Shani be loose in your life. This is the finger of the sun. This is called the Divya Angusht. This is called the divine finger. Where you can actually change your karma if you know how to send your personal shakti, your personal prana out through your... You can actually rewrite your karma with this finger. And many gurus rewrite and a lot of initiation is done with this finger. This is called the finger of the sun, because the sun is the literal source of life. Quite apart from the divine nature of the sun is literally the source of life. So this is the sun vibration and this is a mercury vibration, Buddha. So when you wear a finger on that, which is why in yoga it is never recommended to wear a It is never recommended to wear a ring on the middle finger because you will activate the Saturn, and which means that all the karma will be released. And it's a water vibration, which means you will become emotionally unstable. Any ring. This finger, it is helpful to wear, especially if you are in a social context, if you wear on your Jupiter finger, because that is activates the power of leadership. That activates the power of, you know, so it's helpful. This finger, it's helpful because it activates, it keeps you spiritual. Now, the ring finger, the left ring finger on which the engagement ring and the wedding ring goes, there was a belief in the Western culture that there is a vein which runs from there into the heart, which of course is not true. That was a belief originally, but that again is a misunderstanding. What the mystics were saying about that vein was, there is actually a very important nadi, there is actually a very important channel of the pranamaya kosha that runs from the left ring finger to the heart, and it's a very stabilizing, a lot of the prana shakti stabilizes. So hardcore yogis for thousands of years wear copper fingers in the form of a snake on their left finger. Isha Foundation, Jaggi Vasudev, Sadhguru Jaggi Vasudev has made it very popular, but it's a yogic practice. It's a yogic practice where they wear copper, usually in the snake shape, because the snake is a symbol of the Kundalini. They wear that on the left ring finger to keep the system stable, to make sure that you won't have some kind of dramatic upsurge, or you won't have some kind of thing which can lead to insanity or even to death sometimes. So it's just a way of keeping the system stable. These are all well practiced, well understood aids. These are tools, these are supports. These are not substitutes for sadhana. This is the one thing that people don't get. That wearing a mala wearing a mala is not enough, you know. The mala is to help you. The mala is to help you, and you know, until you can deal with the responsibility of wearing a mala, don't wear. You cannot wear a mala all the time, 24 hours, you cannot wear a rudraksha unless you are intensely in sadhana and intensely connected to the force, to the shakti. Otherwise you will fall ill, you will be suffering from intense heat, you will be volatile, mood swings, all those kind of things will happen. That is not the fault of the rudraksha. That is your fault for not playing according to the rules. Now, so multiple things, you know, certain kinds of bells, you know, you use that certain kind of bell, especially those Tibetan bells which have that very humming, woong woong, that kind of, you know, those are all, when you use that, it is an external physical method of shifting. It is an external physical method of shifting the vibration in the home. When you light a diya, for instance, I've said this before, I'll say it again, when you light a diya, you instantly change the energy vibration of the room. Because the flame automatically enhances the akasha tattva, it enhances the element of space, it enhances the limitless quality of life. So that is the reason why the first thing in the morning, as soon as you get up, light this. So connect directly to the source, connect directly, go right back to the source of life. That is what a fire does, you know. So the problem is we just do all these things mechanistically. Nobody explains to us that this is the deeper reason, this is the yogic reason. And even if I explain to you, until you come to that state of sadhana, until you come to that state of vibration, where you can see that, that as soon as you light the flame, as soon as you light that lamp, and it's an oil lamp or a ghee lamp, and the way, boom! You know, this is the month of Kartik. I put it up on the Sangha page, on the Arya Yoga Sangha page. But Kartika Masa, the month of Kartika, is the holiest month in the Hindu calendar, where karma phala activates. You get the benefits of your sadhana and everything. And there's this very interesting thing in South India, where basically in every room of your house, you're supposed to light a lamp, a diya. But if you can't do that, because you're lazy or because you can't for whatever, at least during Kartika month, which is going to continue till December 6th, 2014, by the way, at least in month of Kartika, light three lamps every evening. One for your own benefit, one for your own growth and progress, one for somebody you really care about, you really love, and one for somebody you detest. You know, because you cannot get the blessing without, you know, that's not an integral process. You have to accept the negative side in life, and you're accepting. At this month, you accept, okay, here, my Shatru, you know, with all that hatred and that negativity, this is for you. Dumbass. So the immediate question is, what if both are the same? Yeah, that happens too. But light three, because again the three is that vibration, it's the three gunas, you know, it is the rajasic, the sattvic. That's a normal question. It's a very human question. What if both are the same, you know? But actually it's the three gunas. It's not even that you, the one you love, the one you hate. It's actually sattva, tamas, rajas. So at this month, if you can consciously engage with the three gunas, it has a cascading effect into the rest of the year. Now, every time to explain this becomes difficult. So they just make it a rule. In the month of Kartika, you light the three lamps. But if you are a yogi, if you are a person who is in certain kind of sadhana and practice, the minute you light it, you understand what's going on. Sattvic vibration, tamasic vibration, rajasic vibration. Now, a candle is not as good as a diya, but a flame is better than nothing. If nothing else than a candle, you know, or maybe three diyas in the rest of the house, you keep candles. But yeah, the flame, you know, you go to temples at this time in South India, the whole temple is ablaze. People make donations and they line up these lamps, you know, thousands and thousands of lamps everywhere. It's just an extraordinary sight to see. Because you see, the smoke that comes off the candle comes off the wax. It doesn't come off the oil. So the quality of the flame is different. That is another thing that as you deepen in yoga, you begin to understand the quality of the flame. For years and years and years now, I don't go anywhere near oil lamps also. It's always ghee. Because what happens when you light a ghee ka chirag, quite apart from that extraordinary fragrance that spreads through the house when you light a ghee ka chirag, but the quality of the flame and the quality of what happens, once you experience that, you can't go back. There is no way. Because the akasha tattva becomes so powerful with the ghee. The flame of the ghee activates the akasha tattva so powerfully. It's like about 100 times more than the best oil lamp.
So that's also a vibrational
thing. It's a vibrational thing. Because the ghee is made from the cow's milk, no? And the cow's milk is regarded as extremely sattvic, and the ghee is a concentrated form of the sattva quality. So that quality is released into the atmosphere. I just can't tolerate. If I look at an oil lamp and the flickering of it, I just can't tolerate. So even though it's a very expensive business, I'm like, okay. You know, the Diwali khas taur se in my house, all the diyas are a ghee, and people think, wow, multi-millionaires come to our building. Like, no. There is something, you do not understand these things unless you are in sadhana. When you are in sadhana and you experience the impact of that, when you experience the impact of having a ghee lamp as opposed to an oil lamp, and people use all kinds of shit oil also, they don't even use some decent oil, you know. They go to the market and they find the cheapest, you know, almost like industrial leftover, and that they will use for diya. Now, how do you expect that to bring about a positive change in your house? You're skimping in front of God. You're skimping in front of, and you expect Akasha Tattva to manifest. Bloody hell. The other place will manifest, you know, lower dimension. You know, a fire actually burns, but it's not just the, any flame is purifying. All yogis know that. Because Agni sada aggressor, Agni is always ahead, Agni is always purifying. Any flame purifies. But the quality of the flame also matters. You know, the quality of the vibhuti that you use, the bhasmam that you use. You know, the yogis, the real hardcore yogis, they go straight to the shamshan and they pull it out from the funeral pyre. All right, difficult. The next best is cow dung, from the ash of the cow dung. And then you put the vibhuti. So how do they do? When you put the vibhuti, when you put the vasmam, how do you do? There's always, you are supposed to hold it between your thumb, between your transcendent. This is what makes us human. This is what separates us from the animal. The opposable thumb and the divine. And where are you supposed to place? After your bath, where do you take? Take that little pinch of vibhuti, you put it here at your ajna because this is your insight. You put it here because this is your power, and you put it here because this is your compassion. So you're supposed to live with insight, power, and compassion. So that is the purpose of that. How much time does it take you? How much time does it take you to take one little pinch of vibhuti, put it here, put it here, put it here? But
what's in the vibhuti itself?
The vibhuti is ash.
Yeah, I know, but what is,
because of the ash, again, because cow dung and because certain the ash that you get from havan, they have a certain rajasic, or they have a certain sattvic quality, and that quality activates, because these are the three very powerful chakras, that quality activates. Now you do the Vaishnava symbol and the Shaiva symbol, those are other reasons. There is a reason why you make it like the U or the Y, and you make that, the what is that called? The Tridanda, Tripanda, Tridanda, whatever it's called. There's a reason why. And if you look at it, how they do it, they put that with the Vasmam, they put that with the white Vasmam, and then they take this pinch of red turmeric and they put it here. Shiva and Shakti. And they take that red turmeric. Now again, turmeric has very cleansing, and in vibrational qualities, turmeric has enormous benefit. Enormous, enormous benefit. It's one of the huge wonder drugs in Ayurveda and everything. So just applying turmeric to your skin, you know, it's done, no? Haldi ka lep lagate hain, shadi ke. Yeah. And it's a very detoxing thing. So if you put turmeric there and there and there, except that you... No, it's better that you put only vibhuti, and vibhuti ke upar you put turmeric, because if you rub turmeric raw into your skin might have an inflamed reaction. You know, and it's better that you don't put turmeric here, you don't put the red chandan or the red turmeric here and here, because it might trigger very badly. But see, the thing about our culture is that anything we do would be in the service of reaching the higher consciousness. Every activity that we do was, because our culture is based on moksha, our culture is based on enlightenment, on attainment. All actions are driven so that we can become liberated. So even when you take that and you just do 1, 2, 3, insight, personal power, compassion. Now, nobody told me this. Just by doing, and just because of the sadhana, it just clicks into the brain. Oh, that's what it means.
I never heard of that. That simple.
No, nobody. It is a trinity. Nobody tells you these things. You come to it. Now, at one time, doing yoga, doing sadhana was organic in the culture. Then it became a habit, and they say, you do like this and you do like that. Now, there's great power in doing that. You know, whenever I'm going to do some very serious spiritual process, that's the first thing I do. I run and I take and three, right across the forehead, and then the red one. And then after that, you know, you've seen my face. After that, you've seen. The minute I do that, you've seen how the energy shifts. You've seen how the whole vibration transforms.
Women can do that? It seems more like...
Better that they don't, because the feminine biology is not quite the same. It's better that they don't, unless they are very, very serious yogis. It's for women, it's better that you stick to the 1, 2, 3. No, because even if you do that, there is a, you take some people, they do the markings even on the hands. Sangha Ganesh, you see, no, he's got that. No, so even if you do that and you are in deep sadhana, it immediately activates certain things.
Feels like those military stripes.
Well, it is a way of keeping that chakra protected. It is a way of keeping yourself protected from contamination. Yeah. It's armband, no? And even warriors used to wear it. No, because those are vulnerable spots. But these are energy vulnerabilities. These are not physical vulnerabilities. Your wrist, you know, Aditi instantly responded because she understood. You know? Yeah. Somebody touched your, yeah. Classic reaction to the, yeah. Do not allow a person you do not know to catch your wrist. It is catastrophic. Just don't allow. And the other thing, you go to these temples and they tie these little threads. Absolutely under no circumstance, they might feel offended. Jerk your hand away and say, no thank you. I don't need. Do not allow anybody to tie any kind of nonsense, because that is all very tamasic, tantric practice. It is not recommended. Don't do it. See, I can talk a lot about these things, but there are reasons why. There are very, very sensible reasons why. Now, they might not make rational sense, but if you are in a process of intense Kundalini yoga, if you are in a process of intense pranayama, you don't need to wait. Just if you don't already feel it within 1 year of doing the kriya, you just do. Insight, power, compassion. You will see instantly. I don't need to sell you or convince you of that. Immediately the thing starts flowing within you. So the problem is the rituals have been left hanging without the support of the personal practice or the personal sadhana. The ring has been left, the mala has been left, you know, everything is at sixes and sevens. And how much can a person say? How much can I tell you? This is the reason why, that is the reason why, you know. But if 6,000 years they are taking this seed and they are stringing it together and wearing it, they are not stupid people. They are intensely practical people. They are intensely fierce people. If it was not working and it was not benefiting, they wouldn't wear it. You know, I have never seen such cold-blooded people like yogis. They are just like, either it works or it doesn't work. So if they are refusing to let go of that, it's because it works. So there are many. Each one of our rituals can be explained from a yogic perspective, from a perfect perspective of this helps you in evolving in your consciousness. This will help you along your journey to attain. This will help you to release yourself from the limitations of your body, your mind, your emotions, and your, even your pranamaya kosha in the end can become a limitation. This will help you to release yourself from your limitations. But that the parents don't understand, even sometimes even the pujaris don't understand, let that be. Even the people marking all that, I'm sure they don't know. They do it because their great grandfather did it. But everything is an integral part, you know, it's all tied together. And the, because we've had a modern English education, we tend to sneer at these things. Oh, that's all remnant of the past. It is not relevant. That is your misfortune. You know, if you think that about wearing vibhuti and all that, that is your misfortune. If you knew how much power, how much help comes from that simple little vibhuti, you would go to office wearing it. But then today we will be thought of as being backward. Or the ring, or the mala, or any of the things you do, you know, or why bel patta is offered to Shiva and not anything else. There's a whole vibrational reason behind it. In the end, in yoga, everything is vibration. This works, this doesn't. This enhances, this doesn't. Why light the diya? Why do this? Why do that? It's all vibrational. It all comes down to vibration. It all comes down to what can you understand? Now, I was not told any of these things. You know, when I first heard about the Kartikeya Masam and they would do it, even though I'm a South Indian, my parents wouldn't practice it. In fact, I realize now that it's not so common amongst Malayalis, it's more common amongst Tamil and the other. Yeah, it's common among the other South Indians. Malayalis are not so, it's not so common, even though I know a few do it. But the minute I started doing it, the whole thing was clear. Because the vibration of the month is such. The minute you have those three diyas and you do this, that what is happening, that it's the gunas are being worked at, and you are in one sense healing your relationship with the person you detest, or you're finally burning up. Actually, it's burning up the last few strands of karma. That be done, you nuisance, and exit my life forever. That's the whole part.
That's
of,
a healthy thing to
That's
do.
A very healthy thing to do. You know, in the new age, they teach cutting the cord, burning the cord. Here, we also teach. But you cannot expect that there will only be good people in your life. Aditya Hridayam Punyam Sarva Shatru Vinashanam. The second verse tells, may all my enemies be destroyed. Jaya Vaham Japam Nityam Akshayam Paramam Shivam. You know, the Aditya Hridayam, one of the most powerful verses in the entire canon. And what do we say in the second verse? Sarva Shatru Vinashanam. May all my enemies be destroyed. And we are starting Aditya Hridayam Punyam, you know, with the pure heart we are starting. And the next expression, so it's exactly the same thing that we do in Kartika Masa. This is for my benefit, this is for the benefit of the person I love, this is Sarva Shatru Vinashanam. Jaya Vaham Japam Nityam. My victory will be eternal, my chant will be eternal. My victory will be enduring, my chant will be eternal. Akshayam Paramam Shivam, the sun is the supreme Shiva. So even when we do our mantra japa and all that, what we are japoing, we should know. You know, but most people don't do mantra japa, no? They do grantha japa, because first this mantra, then that mantra. And I'm like, so where is the shakti supposed to flow? From which channel? You've got 7 channels simultaneously activated, traffic jam ho gaya. No wonder nothing is happening to you. You take one mantra at a time, see, get the karma phala of the mantra, then if necessary, move on to the next one. No, 7 mantras simultaneously going on, and then they complain that nothing is happening in life. Nothing should happen in the life of such stupid people. So these tools, these aids to yoga are actual helps, are actual benefits if you are at a certain level of vibration. If you are at that level of vibration, it's like a crocodile going into the water. It is so natural. But most of us are not like that. No? We are dissociated from our culture. We are dissociated from the wisdom of our culture. So we think, oh man, what is this? What is this thing wearing malas, putting this ash? So old-fashioned. So
they ask the guru to charge the mala. What is that?
It's true. You can take your... What happened? All right. I can take my personal shakti and I can infuse the mala with it. And because it's a rudraksha, it will stay for quite some time. But if you're not doing your personal sadhana or your practice, it'll dissipate. Again, that is not a very yogic thing to do. That is just a superstition. Oh, the guru gave it to me, therefore. Of course, the guru gave it to you, that is a benefit. But if you don't keep your practice up, that benefit will dissipate. People don't understand that. That, you know, going to the guru is well and good, wonderful. But if you don't keep your practice up, what you could get goes. If you keep your practice up and you're constantly going to the guru, then each time you go, your capacity to receive widens. Your abilities deepen. But if you're just going and sitting there, then just the personal energy field of the guru or the parampara is working on you. You're not helping in any way. They have to push against your biological resistance, your mental resistance, your emotional resistance. You're not helping in the process. You're actually becoming a vigna. Why should the guru waste his time on a jackass? So I'm not saying it's wrong to take it from the guru, but it's much more important. It's very helpful to take it from the guru. But do not rely just on that I got the mala, therefore that's it. I can now retire, I can stop, I can go on holiday where my sadhana is concerned. That doesn't help. That doesn't help in any way. It always helps to have an object that was used by the teacher, because that vibrational intensity remains in that object. That is all. That should not become a superstitious substitute for your actual effort on your own part, which is the problem there, which is the issue there. Yes? Sarvam Shodhayam.